This is the CC Radio Podcast.
Welcome to episode 254 of the Countdown Podcast. Today we are taking you to the School of Hard Cocks Knocks. My name is Wayne.
And my name is Paul. Welcome to the podcast. We count down movies, sometimes television, in order of awesomeness so you do not have to. And as Wayne has suggested, today is a little bit of an experimental episode.
We do these occasionally.
Chris from the Faces and Aces podcast, who said, why don't you do something like the top 10 things you've learned from film?
Yeah.
That was too broad. So we narrowed it down and we thought, well, what matters to us? We've done dating.
Mm-hmm.
Fighting.
Yeah.
Well, not that we do any fighting, really.
No, we don't do a lot of fighting because we're 45 and can't really keep that shit up anymore.
You know, unless you count domestically.
What's that? Yes, exactly. We have a war of wits.
No. So in other words, but we thought it might be fun. Like, what are the lessons that we have taken away
from movies?
Fight scenes in films. So that's what this countdown is going to be all about. And we'll get into the particulars of that.
Yes. Is it serious? Is it not serious? Is it both? What's the deal? Yep. How do we play it? It's interesting.
That's what we're going to do, but we're going to get there on the other side of two segments today.
The hell do you say?
The first of which is a returning favorite.
Who wants a recap?
Who
wants a recap?
Who
wants a recap?
Who
wants a recap?
The recount is where we hear what you had to say to us last week, Paul.
Well, this is not really so much about last week, because there's some really great feedback from a couple of the listeners of the show.
Cool.
And the first of which is from a relatively new listener to the show. Well, as you'll hear, not that new. This is from Mina Harker.
Mina Harker.
He went, I did it! I started listening to the countdown almost 1 year ago, and I finally finished the back catalogue starting at episode 41, which was the earliest that I could find.
Whoa.
I listened through improved audio equipment, the birth of the soundboard, Wayne's new hip, and some amazing guest hosts. I've laughed at Wayne's irrational and unwarranted hatred toward of virtual Wayne. Thank you, Mina.
Oh, God.
I've cried at some really questionable selections. Hello, Children of Men is a great date movie.
That's Paul.
All aimed at me. And as I almost hurled at the top 10 most disturbing scenes, which is the one episode that I didn't finish because after Paul's number 8, I didn't want to find out what was worse.
That episode was delightfully gross.
It was. Things I've learned from Paul to expand my horizons and watch films out of my comfort zone.
Oh, good
from
one.
Wayne, that it's okay to like films that others hate and to stand by my opinions.
Damn right.
And from guest host Janelle, that apparently, yes, I do find Australian accents sexy AF.
Ba-boom.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
I have to wait a week between episodes. I can finally explore some of the many other podcasts that have been advertised on the show. Thanks, guys, for being wonderful. 10 films at a time. I will never tire from hearing your voices. So long as you keep up the content, I will keep listening.
Big love, dog. That's the man.
Thanks so much, man. I really appreciate your response and feedback, because whenever anyone takes the time to write something like that,
hell yeah,
that's special.
Very kind.
AF, to use your vernacular. Now, the other one is from a long-time listener to the show. I'm not sure how to frame this now, given the content of the email, but
okay,
from Spence. We'll go with Spence.
Spence.
Yeah, now you'll know, you'll hear this and you'll understand. Hello, Paul and Wayne. It's been a long time without an email, and I feel like Wayne hasn't cried enough in a bit, so I wanted to check back in.
Thank you.
It's been about a year, at least, since my last email, and things have really changed. I've started a new school, my podcast won an award. Congratulations.
Wow, nice work.
And my personal life has severely changed. Aside from my dating life still being quite shit, I've made some small discoveries about myself that have become big discoveries to now becoming a new person. Whoa. Over the last 14 months, I've been on a path of self-betterment, trying to become a better person and harder worker with things and people who deserve my attention and becoming my truer self. Oh yeah, I should probably mention I now have a new name, Adelaide. I figure as Aussies you can probably respect that a bit. This is James Spence.
James Spence.
Who is transitioning now.
Holy crap.
Adelaide.
Brave as fuck.
Hell yeah. But enough about me. I just want to remind you, at a time when things are shit around the world and nothing seems to be going the way that we want, the world moves on and people still try to help each other. That's what I've learned since coming out. Everyone has been so supportive and understanding, but in all that fear, in the quiet moments in my bedroom contemplating if it's even worth to go through the hassle of telling everyone who I really am, in the hallways where I could feel my body convulsing, feeling wrong, I still had you two in my ear reminding me that people cared and that I could laugh. Even in Wayne's bullshit lists and Paul's pretentious wank and how much I screamed at both your shit tastes, I never felt unwelcome or that I was alone. Each time I email you, I feel like my life got hit with something really relatively catastrophic, but I'm just so happy with who I am now. I wanted to make sure you knew how special your show and you two are. Over 300 episodes into a show which often devolves into a dick measuring contest, you've cultivated something so unique and brilliant and sincere that it makes my time in this process easier. And that means the world to me. So thank you both so much for everything you do and make.
Wow. I kind of want to cry a bit.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Adelaide.
So, that's awesome, man.
That is awesome.
Hey, lady. I'm so sorry. I don't know what we said. Like,
well, what's cool? Adelaide.
You know what? Adelaide. Yeah, what's up?
We haven't got a preferred pronoun, so we'll go with Adelaide.
I call men and women both dog. It goes, it goes well and sometimes not so well.
Except when you quote Sean Connery.
You're the man now, dog!
No, we're for Adelaide.
Adelaide, what's up?
And I thank you, Adelaide,
and welcome,
for your permission to share that email on the show, which I really feel very special about. And that is incredibly heartfelt. And, you know, it's moments like these where it's like, you know, what we've been doing this 5 years almost. Five-year anniversary coming up. We'll talk about that later. And, you know, sometimes you go like, should we be bothering? Mm. We haven't taken over the world yet. What's going on? Yeah. And then you get an email like this and it all becomes... put
and
into
also,
perspective.
It's nice for me to witness such brave people, because I myself am not very brave.
Oh, that's incredibly brave. I mean, you made half joke about it, but I think I can see its sincerity, and 100% echo that. So thank you, Adelaide. Thank you, Mina. That's pretty incredible feedback today for the recount. That's what we wanted to share with you. Thanks so much. Let's get into another segment that we haven't heard in quite some time.
And what might that be?
It goes a little like this.
Uh-oh.
Sick Gal Watch.
Hell no, we have not had one of these for a while.
How could we possibly do an episode about top 10 things I've learned about fighting without checking in with our least favorite celebrity, Steven Seagal?
We are not fans.
We are not. Now, look, to be fair, Mr. Seagal has been relatively quiet. I had to search a little bit more.
He's probably eating.
I suppose he's not been doing making films, because there's been nothing in the last 6 or 9 months since we last checked in with him. So instead, I found a couple of bits and pieces, the first of which is going to potentially blow your mind.
What?
Maybe I'll come back to that in a second. All right. The first of which is just a bit more about the feud between Van Damme and Seagal.
Oh.
Okay, so Seagal openly questioned Van Damme's real-life credentials and apparently challenged him to a fight, along with Don the Dragon Wilson.
Really? I know Don the Dragon.
Well, he was a renowned world championship kickboxer turned action star who challenged Van Damme to a fight, and Van Damme declined there.
Is that so? I didn't know that.
And Van Damme apparently declined Seagal as well. So that's the rumors. And indeed, vice versa. Apparently, eventually, at some point, Van Damme challenged Seagal to a fight and he declined as well. So at a party hosted by Stallone on one occasion, Seagal made a hasty exit upon hearing JCVD had turned up wanting to square up.
No way! He fucked off!
Stallone himself has confirmed.
Really? That is awesome! Can you know what? Seagal is like 6'5", and Van Damme is like my height, pretty much, right? You would think he'd be able to... You know what? He's too fat to move.
I'm not sure when that was. Yeah, yeah. There's no information about that. In the other part that came out of this article, which I have to give credit to Flickering Myth, I believe it was. Yes, so check out flickeringmyth.com. Seagal made his connections through a martial arts dojo, and apparently he instructed Sean Connery in how to fight for James Bond films.
Seagal?
Yeah.
Did Seagal say this?
And here's the claim. During the shoot for Never Say Never Again, he broke Connery's wrist.
Really?
First of all, with all that we've heard about Steven Seagal, can you for a moment imagine that he wouldn't go that step too far and break an actor's
list? Absolutely.
All right. What a fuckwit.
Remember also that Never Say Never Again was the last Connery Bond. It was the one where he said, I'm done with this character. He looks about 60 in the fucking role.
Right.
All right. So it's absolutely like him with Kim Basinger, that movie.
Oh, yeah.
That it was. So he could easily have broken his wrist by himself.
jerking off to Kim Basinger. Yeah.
I mean, I did.
Broke your wrist?
Yeah. Okay, good.
So the other one, here's the one I thought might blow your mind. This is from movieweb.com. Brace yourself, Wayne.
All right.
Before Warner Brothers agreed to have Michael Keaton star in 1989 Batman, they were out looking for someone to take on a more action-oriented aspects of the character, potentially overlooking the Bruce Wayne aspect.
Oh, no.
Says screenwriter Sam Hamm, there are a lot of people at Warner Brothers who wanted to cast an action star. One of the original picks was Steven Seagal.
Can you imagine how different my life would have been if Steven Seagal was Batman?
Oh my God, can you imagine that world we would now live in?
Oh no.
I'm pretty sure that would be the first sign of the end of time.
Yes, it would be, because there'll be none of this, like, second awakening of his career like Michael Keaton had. Where, you know, like, oh my God, Steven Seagal. It would have been a shit show.
Can you imagine Steven Seagal in Birdman?
Oh, God. But to him, he really thinks that he can float in the air and shit. Oh, my God. That's nuts, man. I had no idea.
I thought you might appreciate that one.
Wow.
We have to now hope. Steven Seagal Watch will now officially come to a close until he does something else stupid.
Okay.
I'm sure it's not far away, but I think we have mined the depths of his
he's full of shit.
Absolute ridiculousness. So there we are. That's Steven Seagal Watch done for the time being, and we're closing that segment off in a very appropriate way. Is the subject of this week's countdown. Now, this is a weird one.
It's weird, all right, man.
We're not sure how the listener's going to respond to this. We're not sure how we're going to respond to this. How did you go about this list, Wayne?
Okay, so it's a potluck thing, okay? You sit there and you think, okay, well, you've got to, I got to find out what movies taught me about fighting. So you try and remember. Because some things, I actually did get taught by movies about fighting.
You have fought much more than I have. You've trained?
Yeah, I was just like a lot of kids, I did like karate as a child.
I thought you did ninjutsu.
I did more. I did like that, kung fu, a bunch of shit. Because okay. I had nothing better to do and obviously wasn't getting laid. So.
Not sure you should be getting laid at 14, Wayne.
Yeah, I know. Just saying. It's more fun to make fun of things. Mm-hmm. And think that, like, well, this is, for me, it became early on in the list, a list of my pet hates about shit that happens about fighting in movies. And that's the thing that I, you know, facetiously learned.
I wonder how much we're similar then, because I've got some very sarcastic takes.
Oh, most of mine are sarcastic takes.
But I've got one or two which I legitimately think is pretty funny.
Yeah.
Without being sarcastic.
The nature of the brief, things you learned, makes it, it's going to be like sarcastic.
So. All right. Well, how about you lead us away then today with your number 10, sir, things that you've learned from movie fight scenes.
Cool. This really always bugged me, all right? The lesson is, no matter how many times someone punches you full contact in the face, you will still be able to crack wise and pontificate on the finer points of fighting. This is from the movie Broken Arrow. All right? Okay. This is always pissed
Although
me off.
It could be in many films.
It could be many
and
films.
I've made that distinction in mind. I haven't bothered to specify films.
If some you can say a
if
few.
If it's across the board.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. In this case, the beginning of the film, there's a boxing match. It's a John Woo movie, by the way. All right? Boxing match between Christian Slater and John Travolta. What is this?
The theme song from Broken Arrow, motherfucker.
Is it? It sounds like fucking Twin Flaps.
Tali's sex tape.
I knew you would do that. Tell me what we're going to use. Okay. Is this
the theme song? It's the actual theme song.
Okay. Check it out, people. I counted it. In this boxing shit, the boxing match between these two in the beginning, Christian Slater takes 37 punches to the face and 3 body shots, right? 3 of the connections to the face are an uppercut that actually knocks him on the floor, okay? I don't mean jabs. Most of them are haymakers, full contact, whatever, right? He never stops smiling and there is zero blood, right? And he got 37 shots to the face. The consequences of this hiding amount to him looking in the mirror in the locker room later on, rubbing his brow and going, ooh. Now let me tell you something. I've gotten my bell rung quite a few times. Maybe quite a few. 3 times. But let me tell you, at one of those times, my legs just gave way. So it always pissed me off that these people keep taking shots to the face in the movies and nothing happens. And then they walk away. You would actually probably die. So that's what I learned from that movie.
100% agree.
It's just...
It's very similar to one of mine later in the list. Very similar, but not quite the same. So that's nice.
But there wasn't even a bruise or a cut. That's my big issue. So anyway.
I remember this is slightly off topic, but I remember my dad saying, like, once when I was like 13 or whatever, and we were watching Lethal Weapon or whatever it was, and he's like, if I drove like that, the police would pull me over 17 times before I got to the city, you know?
Oh, God.
That's kind of where we're coming from, I think.
Absolutely. That's how they go
with this list. So my number 10 is, all right, this comes from The Last Action Hero.
Oh.
I put a round number on this, but not a round number, a number on this. Sidekicks are roughly 5.13 times more likely to be caught or killed than their hero counterparts.
Yeah, I'd probably go with that. Mm-hmm. How much more lately?
What, 5.13?
5.13 sounds about right.
Because it makes that joke in the film where the kid realizes, I'm the sidekick. Holy shit, that's I'm going to be killed off. But like, that's the film that makes fun of it. But it's absolutely the truth. Like, Think of even... I'm going to spoil a film here.
Go on.
All right. It's called Hell or High Water.
Oh, with...
Jeff Bridges.
Yeah.
And Chris Pine Ben Foster. And yeah. Pretty much everyone who's a psychic in that film doesn't last long.
Oh, yeah. They're all like red jerseys in Star Trek. You know what? The function of you dying as a sidekick is the inverse proportion to how entertaining you are. If you're well-liked, as in by the audience, you're probably going to die.
Also, it depends on the rating of the film.
But if you're funny... Like, I suppose.
That's probably the most... The harder R it is, the less chance you have of surviving.
You're going down.
You might get incapacitated or kidnapped if you're in a PG film.
You're definitely getting kidnapped.
Probably not going to die.
Yeah.
All right, so that's my number 10.
All right. This one here is a very odd one, but it, again, is one of my pet hates. The lesson is that a shit flying kick will usually save the day. Now,
do you have a particular...
I have many, right? So let's just say, okay, for example, this is funny because you hate this movie and I like it, but in Revenge of the Sith, this happens in lots of movies. When I tell you what it is, you're going to recognize it from lots of movies, okay? Basically, it involves two opponents, right? One guy, in order to gain, I guess, control over the fight, launches himself at the other guy feet first. Now, there's a difference between a formal flying kick, like an actual flying kick, and just throwing your body at someone with your feet
because
first.
Because inevitably, if A, you don't hit, or B, you don't hit perfectly, you end up on the ground now, and your opponent's still standing.
Absolutely! It is the worst move ever. Because first of all, people, think about
it. Instinct.
Someone running at you, right, and going to the effort of launching himself into the air, that takes a lot of time and a lot of effort, and it's quite slow usually, right? By the time he flies towards you in the air with his feet out, you will just sidestep it or move backwards.
Too many Street Fighter fucking games.
That's right, and he can't land back on his feet because he's put his feet up near his head.
And if you can get both legs up that high without your head slamming into the ground immediately,
it actually depends on you making contact so that you can roll off someone and actually get off there. But it does. It's just the worst move ever. But you see it all the time. Yep. It's really offensive for me.
I'm with you for sure.
So there you are. Captain Kirk, by the way, did this in that famous shitty fight. Totally.
All right, my number 9 then is this, and it comes largely from Indiana Jones in Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Okay.
Or potentially Malone in The Untouchables. It's not really a fight scene.
Oh yeah.
If a hero pulls out a superior weapon and wins a fight with it,
yeah.
E.g., those two examples.
Exactly.
It's comedic and more than okay. If a villain or their hench people do it, it's a lowly, despicable act for which they must be punished.
Absolutely.
And punished severely.
Hell yes. Hell yes.
Double fucking standards.
It is played for laughs when Indiana Jones pulls his pistol out and shoots the swordsman.
Yep.
When someone else pulls a second gun who's a bad guy. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, but like, you know, if we both put down our weapons and we're gonna square up here for a fight, but then inevitably the bad guy's losing, so he goes back for the weapon.
Yep, it's like, oh, that dirty bastard.
You wank.
Can't believe he swung that shit. Yep,
so why is it okay one way and not the other?
Absolutely. It's just like life. Whoever's on your team wins.
Right, there you go.
Okay. Now, number 8. Let me just give it paint something here for you, Polly. Let's say you are in a SWAT team or a tactical team or just a bunch of bad guys with guns, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And let's say there's 10 shooters in your team, including you, all right?
Okay.
All of you have guns and your objective is to kill one guy who has no gun. Got it? So
no equal.
All right? Just an unarmed man. And you don't just have handguns. You've got
it disturbs me how quickly you got on my side wavelength there.
Jeff Speakman joke, everyone. You've got submachine guns and shit, okay? So it's known by you and your team that the mark that you're after is unarmed and your objective is to shoot him. Now, you might think that given that objective, if you were in a room or a bunch of corridors or in a space where you're shooting that guy and you see him from afar, you might just aim your gun and shoot him, right?
Well, it seems logical.
Yeah, that's not what happens in fucking movies, okay? Rather than shooting at him, according to all of Hollywood, what you have to do is run towards the mark. You can aim your gun at him, but you cannot fire for some reason, okay? You can only fire after you have closed the distance enough to be within reach of his hands so he can intercept the gun and beat you up and beat up all the 10 of your friends.
There is no better example of this than Harley Quinn in Birds of Prey.
Dude, as fucking recently as last night we saw this.
Yeah.
Right? We're sitting there going... Because what happens is, right, in an action scene, if they're going to focus on the person with no gun who's trying to fight people with lots of guns, right, nothing can happen until the opponent turns up in that frame. But that means that the person would have seen you from across the room and waited to shoot until they got right next to you, and it gives me the shits. This happens a lot in the first John Wick as well, I will tell you, all right? Because That's just how it is.
How dare you,
sir. I know. It does happen, but it totally gives me the shit. And I don't know. It's just... So I guess the lesson is when you're up against a bunch of guys, don't worry. They will not fire until you're close enough to actually take them out.
Yeah, I get you. I totally get you. I mentioned before then, so that's a good number eight. My number eight is one that hails back to your number 10.
Yeah.
Any participant in a fight that has their name above or just below the title on a film's poster will take roughly 16.73 times as many blows as to incapacitate as someone whose name does not appear on the poster. And that comes from every action film ever.
I knew you would put science behind this.
I mean, obviously, I'm making these numbers up.
That's why it's funny. I like that happens. Obviously, your top build has plot armor.
Yes.
And yes, he's going to get taken out last.
And I will make another allusion to that in a different way later in my list. I have now realized.
Okay, my number seven. Everyone, in 1985, there was a movie released called Gymkata. Gymkata. Basically, okay. I know, listen, it's an action film. It's an 80s martial arts action film, all right? Someone thought it would be a good idea to give Olympic gold medalist and full-time mullet enthusiast Kurt Thomas a starring role in a martial arts movie. This is probably worth a YouTube search for anyone who happens to be, okay? Because this
Gym
is what...
Gymkata, you're calling it?
Gymkata, right? In the film, a former gymnast is set upon in some village by like 60 dudes who are trying to kill him, okay? It's not the whole movie. There's many scenes like this. But basically, the movie becomes a an excuse for this guy who obviously knows gymnastics to fight people by finding suspiciously gymnast-looking equipment around the town and then using that to beat people up.
What?
Right?
No.
Seriously, there's one scene, right, where the guy is like, this whole town village is trying to kill him, right? So he runs around until he gets to a courtyard where in the dead middle of the courtyard is something that looks really suspiciously like a stone pommel horse with like the handles and everything.
With the handles.
It's got handles on it, man. It's got handles. So he gets up and basically does a routine where his legs flail, but everyone comes in and sticks their face in.
Exactly the right moment.
Yeah, exactly right. So he can kick them, and he's kicking and taking out like 200 cunts, right? And that's the. And then in another scene, he's in a, like a thin alley, but there happens to be a bar across the top, really high up, that he can jump on and swing around and just kick everyone who comes down the alley.
Don't bars exist in all alleys?
Yeah, okay. And just one other thing. There's actually a scene in here, and this is actually worth... I should probably just do a GIF or something. He's fighting a bunch of people, and he goes and does a backflip next to someone, and that person gets knocked down. I don't know what happened. I don't know why. He's just
maybe it was the sheer weight, force landing on the ground, like the T-Rex.
It was. I think what happened was he was supposed to kick the guy as he flipped and over, but he missed, and the guy did just reacted on time. And the director's like, "Fuck it." So yes, that's the lesson, I guess, is if you're gonna get beat up and you're an ex-gymnast, don't worry about it. You'll find a pommel horse in the middle of the fucking place and kick everyone's ass.
Stupid, but ballsy.
Okay.
Very nice, sir. My number seven is, here we are. This is from The Karate Kid. Illegal kick/moves are allowed in martial arts tournaments if either A, a villain uses them in the early rounds, or B, the hero uses them in the final while injured. These are mutually exclusive concepts. A hero cannot use such moves in the early rounds, and a villain cannot use them in the final to win.
Now, the whole thing about Karate Kid, of course, is that move is illegal as shit.
Yeah, that's my point. Because
it's face contact, right?
So there's plenty of cheating, whatever, by Johnny, whatever the fuck his name is.
Johnny, that guy, yeah.
Yeah, in the early rounds, and by the rest of his, whatever they're called, Cobra Kai.
That's right.
They don't, they'll do illegal shit to get through if they can get away with it.
Yes.
But then Daniel-san.
That's right.
Does uses a kick, and that they specifically say.
No facial contact.
And he kicks Johnny right square in the middle of the fucking face. And the referee goes, "All there!"
Really?
Well, I don't know.
Something else.
Touchdown is what I was doing here in the studio.
I always had a problem with the crane kick. I don't really understand it. Like, he's on one foot, and then he jumps in the air and kicks with that foot, then lands on the other foot.
Surely the Cobra Kai sweep the leg would be equally effective against the crane kick.
Absolutely. All you have to do is trap it. And then I think they do that.
Even more so, because there's only one leg on the floor.
Yeah, and the second... Also, your balance is shit. So the second movie, the guy actually does counter it. So that completely fucks off the whole, there's no defense for this shit. And also, when Cobra Kai sweep the leg, what he actually does is not sweeping the leg.
Isn't it?
Well, literally sweeping the leg in my, from what I understand.
Well, you're the trained martial artist.
Well, it's basically like a move where you spin and you get momentum and your leg comes out close to the floor and knocks the legs off the feet out of other people.
Isn't that sweeping the leg?
Yeah.
Sounds very sweeping the leg.
That's sweeping the leg.
No, what are the Cobra Kai guys?
The Cobra Kai guy catches Daniel's leg, locks it up and drops his elbow on his knee. That's what he does. What he's doing is he's fucking up Daniel's knee. That's not sweeping the leg.
Illegal move.
Yeah, big time illegal move.
But imagine how he won the fight on that point.
Oh God!
Didn't he get penalized in the?
Yeah, no, he got thrown out.
Yeah,
and then because it was the guy before him. Exactly. Yeah. So yeah, it was just. But that's not sweeping the leg. Anyway, so there you are.
That was a lot.
We're geeking out about fight.
Longer
shit.
Discussion than I anticipated for my number seven. No, it's all good. Your number six, sir.
My number six is something that I myself, and this is a little bit weird, but I'm just going to tell you, I always thought this ever since I was a kid. The movie Lethal Weapon, all right?
Okay, yeah.
Now, at the end of Lethal Weapon, all right, a shirtless Mel Gibson and Gary Busey fight, okay? But they fight, pretty much what happens is Gary Busey has been caught. There's heaps of cops around, including Murtaugh, right? And somehow, Gary Busey and Mel Gibson get into a fist fight with Mel Gibson.
And Murtaugh's like, stay back, sir. Yeah. Let him do it.
The thing is, Mel Gibson actually goes, you want a shot at the title? Don't mind if I do. That's what I find Gary, right? And then so they get into it. There are hundreds of cops around everywhere, and there's a point in the fight where it looks like Mel Gibson's going to get drowned by Gary Busey. Mm-hmm. And then Murtaugh's like, let me get in there. And he's like, no. And I'm like, so the 200 cops around, is anyone going to stop this? Like, what's going on here, right? You're going to just let the guy die. That's the other thing. But the real thing I've met that I found was that Gary Busey, he gets beaten by the fight by Mel Gibson wrapping his legs around Gary Busey's neck, and Gary Busey is facing down. So it kind of looks like Gary Busey is sucking his dick. And I remember going to myself, this doesn't sit well with me. No one looks badass when it looks like you're forcing someone to suck your dick.
Whoa, hold on.
I remember thinking it was oddly sexy or something, and that wasn't sitting right with me at the time. Okay, there. That's what I said. Paul's burying his head in his hands.
Ain't my bag,
he's
baby.
Burying his head in his hands. I don't see any problem with this whatsoever. It was odd. Okay.
You're mocking me, aren't you?
What? Oh. This is fine. It's fine.
You had to go there.
It's fine. It looked weird to me at the time. Why didn't he lock him up from behind?
This episode was a bad idea.
Why didn't he lock him up from behind? It was just a weird thing to film, and I was like, "What is this?" So that's the.
Jeez.
I don't think there's any problem with this at all. And trust me, I've sucked dick.
Okay. If that's what Wayne wants to admit on the air, then fine. Fine.
I didn't suck a pie, but I sucked dick.
My number six comes from a listener, Tara Maholic, reminded me of this scene.
All right.
I just want to give a big shout out to her. Thank you so much, Tara, for your support of the show. It comes from Shaun of the Dead.
Okay.
If forced to resort to whatever comes to hand as a weapon, vinyl records are an exceptionally poor choice, other than helping sort the wheat from the chaff. In terms of, so here we are, Wayne, now I'm going to put you on the spot.
Yeah.
Imagine that your digital library is now a library of vinyl records.
Oh, yes.
Which ones would you throw and which ones would you keep?
Oh, okay.
A la the scene between Sean and Ed.
Right. Look, there was a time where, like, yeah,
not organized at all.
U2 gets thrown first. The U2 stuff gets thrown first, okay?
So you got U2 on.
Got a lot of U2, right? Because I had a
thing. Chuck it.
Yeah, that's gone. You know what gets kept? All the boy band stuff, right?
Is there any chance that we can throw John Mayer?
No, John Mayer will be behind me, man. Like, that's it. I go before the John Mayer ones go.
Now I'm just flashing to a backdraft. Wayne is holding his,
you go.
His fucking physical collection of John Mayer albums. Yes.
You go. We go. I mean, I feel we may have come off the topic somewhat. So wait, what exactly?
So U2 is your only thing you would
throw? No. There's heaps of shit I would throw out, but like
no, but what'd you throw to save your life to try and from approaching a horde of zombies?
Ah, look, if I think records are a good call, then they're all going.
Yeah, but the whole point is they're not that good a call. But I just thought it was jumping off which. Anyway, there you go. That's my number six.
So did he do that in Shaun of the Dead?
Yeah, don't you remember that scene?
He chucked all the records.
Yeah, there's like Batman soundtrack. Chuck, and he's like, no, oh, that was a limited first edition. Saturday, chuck it.
Saturday.
Dire Straits, throw it.
Remember how much we liked Dire Straits back in the day?
Yeah.
All right, okay. All right, man, my number five is Bridget Jones's Diary.
Please explain.
Okay, now, I adore the fight scenes in both these movies, and I don't mind telling you that these two fight scenes in these two Bridget Jones 1 and 2 movies are in fact the only part of both movies that I've seen. I'm talking about the fight between... That's right. Between Colin Firth and Hugh Grant. Now, what this scene taught me was that even though you're in a street fight to the death, that's no reason to forget your manners. And see, this is wonderfully British, this whole scene. I absolutely love it, okay?
A sad, strange little man.
As these two throw each other around like a classy restaurant, and it's the most stupid, like, old man fight ever, where they just it just looks ridiculous on purpose.
Well, other
really,
than the
really
Irishman.
Funny. Yeah, well, this is intentionally funny. Yeah, okay. But as they're getting thrown around this classy restaurant, it's peppered with very British apologies to the patrons between blows. Like
this one?
Fuck you, fuckball.
No, not at all.
Oh, okay.
Hugh Grant gets thrown onto a dinner table in the middle of two diners, and as he's getting punched, he's apologizing to the diners, like, sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, sorry. And then Colin Firth gets slammed into a dessert tray.
Who's he apologizing to? The other diners?
The two people whose table they were sitting at when he got thrown on it, right? And then Colin Firth gets slammed into a dessert tray on another couple, and he's like, I'm so sorry, I'll definitely pay for everything. And then he gets thrown away again. Really good. At one point, they stop to join in happy birthday. That's getting some by the waiters to some cake to some kid.
And at any point when they're apologizing, do they roll this one out?
You're a cunt. You're a cunt now.
No, it's not that kind of British. And it's not the Oxford kind, not the Geordie kind.
I had to search hard for the British thing on the soundboard.
That's what you're doing the whole time, motherfucker.
I haven't heard a word you said.
Fucking bitch! This is the kind of show I have to do, everyone. But yes, anyway, yes, it costs you nothing to be polite. So that's what I think is cool about this scene.
So what, your lesson is be polite while in a fight?
Yeah. I actually think it would be cool
put
if you're polite.
Put that on a fucking shirt, motherfuckers.
I'm thinking. Gonna fight, be polite. Nice.
Thank you.
Talent.
All right, very good. My number five, very straightforward, very easy to describe. It does come from Raiders of the Lost Ark in particular, but again, countless action films do rest on this trope. All my blows as the hero the piece. I left the pregnant pause and Wayne
it's okay,
leapt
away,
in as I knew
away.
That he would. Will land with a sound not dissimilar to a wet towel slapping a wall or a freight train hitting a mountainside.
You're talking about the Raiders sound effects?
Yes. And can I now regale you live
please
with what I'm talking about?
Some bass.
Oh yeah, I think that's a good couple of examples. That was a long shot away, by the way.
Yeah,
when Indy and the big dude are on the top.
I remember
of the biplane.
Yeah,
not biplane, whatever it is, bomber.
From Raiders, I remember that when he used to, there was a scene in the bar with Marion Ravenwood. He fires his gun and hits people. Both things sound the same. It's
yes. Oh, I could have gone for that one. Yeah. That'll do. That'll do us nicely for today. But yeah, that is what I expect if I'm ever the hero in an action film for my punches.
Okay.
To sound. But of course, you know, punches sound
in the whole room. No. You know, funny thing, the most realistic punches I've ever heard are Batman 1989.
Really?
It actually, if you go back to the Joker in the Tower, it's just that. That's what it is. Huh? It's really cool.
That's the one thing that went under
exactly.
Not over exaggerating.
Huge. Nice one. Well, that's pretty cool. Now my number four is actually a serious one, and I'm sorry to put a serious one in the middle of all this, but
it's funny because my number four is also serious.
There you go. Well, I've always been impressed by this fight scene, and it's the only time I've actually seen genuine fight principles employed in a Hollywood film. This scene is from the movie Troy with Brad Pitt and Eric Bana. And in this film, there's another reason I love Brad Pitt. In every fight scene, Brad Pitt's form is like technically perfect, right? But what happens more than that? What happens is...
Yeah, that's the reason he loves Brad Pitt, everyone.
Exactly. It's one of the many reasons. Every time Brad Pitt is approaching an enemy for the first strike in this movie, instead of attacking head on, all right, he does these huge lunges from side to side, left to right, before he closes the distance up to the person. And that is actually what you're supposed to do.
Okay.
When you attack someone. You're not supposed to attack someone head on because they've got like...
They're ready for you.
Well, all their defenses and stuff are geared towards a full frontal attack.
Yeah, yep.
So what happens is when it's better to attack them from a tangent because that will... Like that will one hit them from one of the angles or sides of their body where they're not that defended, and they will be forced to improvise a defense to that, which is better for you. But also, it either forces them to step backwards, and that changes their preferred like stance because like now their less preferred foot is forward and shit like that. So it puts them off balance.
Okay,
so that's cool, and he does it every single time in the movie. So very cool. So yeah, sorry, it's not funny, but
no,
that is always
not,
very
not
cool.
All of them can be funny, and neither is mine. Number four, oddly enough, and it comes from a lesson from a film which. We do love.
When the big man was killed, you must have wanted it. Its blood was on the leaves.
Oh, God.
If it bleeds,
we can kill it.
That's it?
That's it, that's it. If it bleeds, we can kill it. Completely understandable. I mean, better if the bleeding is fluoro green.
Yeah, yeah. I wish the sound bite had been better. That's the best one I could find. I'm sorry.
It's all right. We're reaching with this episode, isn't it? Okay. Well, this is funny then, because my number three is from the movie 22 Jump Street.
Well, okay.
Okay, good. Paul, you're going to have a problem with this one. Now, this is one of my favorite fight scenes, and I even put it in a countdown of favorite fight scenes once. It is the awkward fight scene between Jonah Hill and Jillian Bell.
Oh, yeah.
Where she punches exactly him, yeah. And he's like, I'm not going to fight a woman, so just back off. And she's like, if you thought of me as a person instead of a woman, you'd hit me and not feel bad about it. And then she goes on to smash his face in, all right? Now, between the punches, they clinch up, and there are odd moments where she tries to kiss him.
Yeah, it's like that, yeah.
And it's weird, and he's like, what the fuck? And she's like, are we going to fuck? And he's like, get off. And she's like, you're making this so uncomfortable. She's like, you're Mr. and Mrs. Smithing me, right? And shit like that. And he's like, this is weird. And then anyway, between punches, she starts sort of leaning in to kiss him, and then he gets angry, and then she gets angry, but she still wants to fuck him. It's a brilliant scene with highly nuanced performances, in my opinion. And the lesson I learned was that should you ever be forced into a position where you have to defend your own life against a girl who's got a gun on you and she's bashing your face in, be sexy to distract her, and then when she tries to kiss you, muff punch her and run away or something.
Okay, just now, like, so now that- I gotta ask Wayne. How do you be sexy to distract her?
Well,
give us a rendition.
Here's what it is, okay? Right as she swings, and then you duck, and then in that time between her setting up again, pretend to care what she thinks about.
Take it back!
Or like ask her what she always wanted. Something like that, okay? Because they don't respond to the normal stuff.
Sorry,
you can't just bare a nipple. anyway, yeah, so that's what I learned from that movie. It's an odd episode, everyone.
Can I completely out of... Please. I'm now really dark at myself that I forgot to use this when you were talking about Gary Busey.
Listen, you snot-nosed little shit. I was taking shrapnel and caisson while you were crapping in your hands and rubbing it on your face.
Even though I hate your soundboard and I hate you. that was actually kind of interesting to listen to.
All right, moving right along then, because I'm not sure what the hell Wayne was going for with his number three. My number three,
you'll find it's awesome,
is a lesson again from every... In fact, all of my last top three are all from every action film ever made. If I'm the good guy, right, and I'm facing off against a large number of attackers, I only need to worry about one at a time because a horde of opponents are incapable of attacking me at once and overpowering me in that way because movies.
Are you trying to tell me that a horde of people will always attack one at a time? Yes.
And if they're surrounding me in a circle, I will be able to dispatch them by swiveling at exactly the right moment, having dealt with one attacker, and then move around to, you know, 45
Those people
degrees.
Do not attack all at once. Nope. It just doesn't work
Which,
out.
Which, you know, maybe just physically it's incapable of swinging punches, but at some point, surely, when there's 50 of you, you just charge the guy, land on him.
Oh, yeah.
And then proceed to kick the living snot
Absolutely.
Out of him.
Absolutely. In fact, that is what has happened to me in many times. Football. So,
so it's a weird thing. It's a weird thing that is such a well-renowned...
I reckon the scene where I found this the first time was Enter the Dragon. Okay? There's that scene where Bruce Lee is busting everyone's ass with the nunchucks.
Yep.
Where he actually kicks Jackie Chan's ass as a stuntman with a staff. Right? And that is where every single person, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this, yeah. And there was 50 of them. So yeah, totally. I think that's a lovely trope, and I've always dug that, to be honest with you. All right, my number two, everyone, is from the movie Die Hard 2.
Oh, look out. Die Harder.
Towards the end of the film, John McClane stops a jumbo jet from taking off by getting onto the wing of that fast-moving plane. And Jimmy
Wayne could make that Freudian slip. Not one other person in the universe.
You're right.
Would have said getting off.
Well, John McClane jammed a jacket in the flap of the wing so that the plane couldn't take off. Brilliant. He then goes on to have a fist fight with two dudes while standing easily on the plane wing, not of a plane taxiing.
Did you say fist wipe?
Fist fight wipe. No, fight. I'm sure I said fight.
You started to say wipe, I'm sure.
I'm sure the table will come back. To wipe it? On the curtains, Paul. Anyway, the fight happens with one dude who John McClane kicks into the engine of the plane and fucks him up.
Yep.
The whole time, the bad guy is at the door of the plane watching John McClane take this guy out. He's got a rifle, right? And chooses not to shoot. Then when John McClane defeats this dude, he still doesn't shoot. He gets onto the fucking wing and tries to kick his ass, all right? Now, first of all, you can't stand on a plane's wing when it's about to take off. So the lesson is, one, no one shoots you when they can fight you and make things far more difficult for themselves. Yeah. But two, as long as you're fighting, you don't have to conform to the laws of aerodynamics or Bernoulli's principle or any of that shit.
Gotcha. That part, yeah, a little similar one you said before, but that part, second part, saves it. So
okay. Well, more importantly, I watched this scene again, and he lights the fucking trail of gas.
That's ridiculous.
It is the worst thing. I didn't realize it was so bad at the time, but it's just...
There's your landing lights, Holly!
Yes, and but the flame... After the plane takes off, the flame chases the winger and it blows up the whole... I was like, wow, that really would never happen.
I think we did the most top 10 at some point, the top 10 most ridiculous moments in action films.
That had to have,
that's the topic worth visiting at some point.
That was huge, that one. It was.
That one surely should be up there. My number two is... But again, from countless films, as I've mentioned, if an action hero has a vulnerable place, it is the testicles. It's the only place that's actually vulnerable. He may go so far as to wince, assuming it's a male action hero, of course. If struck there and pause for almost a nanosecond before destroying the opponent who placed that low blow.
Good God. That's true, because I reckon every time someone gets... Like, if you get hit in the nuts, everyone goes, oh, it's okay if you're the action hero. Anyone who gets hit in the nuts goes down, right? So that's why they...
But if you're the action hero, as opposed to being hit anywhere else, in the nuts will actually give you pause.
Pause. It won't actually destroy you like it would like a normal man.
No, exactly.
Absolutely.
That's my number two.
Side note, I was once at a tournament thing, and there was a dude there from Bali or something. He's like a kickboxer. Some other dude kicks him fair in the nuts, as in like right up there, full contact. He just kind of shrugs it off, pulls his like balls a bit, and then keeps fighting.
Wow.
I know. Apparently, the story goes, his control or whatever is so good. That's what I heard, man.
Wow.
Or he has no balls.
I have a comparable story.
Go on.
Year 11.
Yeah.
Year 10, actually. Year 10.
Yeah.
Cleanup day. Can't remember why, but Amanda Souza was really annoying.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Amanda Souza was a girl who we used to go to high school with, everyone.
And I got stuck into her a little bit. Can't remember why. Or even what I said. All I remember is she wound up with a kick that I was like, I saw it coming going, she's not gonna. There's no way she would. She drove my testicles into my throat.
Fuck!
Like, I was on the floor.
That is a...
Cupping my bad boys.
That is a...
Like, with tears coming out of my eyes. Half laughing, half like screaming in agony.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. That's a rite of passage for a man, any of you ladies out there.
Yep.
The first kick, that may not have been your first, but that whole situation is the pain.
I think it was my first.
Yeah, it's the pain only a man can feel, and it's a rite of passage. You're like, holy shit. So
yeah, I deserved something for whatever shit I was giving her. I don't think I deserve that.
I got once kicked in that nut. So actually, a few times. But one time, Coralie Cox kicked me in the ass.
Funnily enough, Amanda Susan and Coralie Cox, good friends.
Yeah, I think so. She kicked me in the ass from behind, but she did it in such a manner that it felt like a shoe was going up my hole. It was really, really...
She targeted.
She did. I was like, holy shit, what kind of fucking sniping you got there going on? Anyway, it was fun. So
Wayne's penchant for ass play has never...
Okay. Oh, Jesus. Okay.
All right, we're not going to do a recap of this.
No, we're not, because I can't fucking say it.
It's too hard to go back through all this. So let's just... Here it is. Here's our number one things we've learned from fights in movies.
My number one is from the movie Casino Royale.
Okay.
Okay, one of my favorite films. Now, Paulie, you ever seen in a movie where there's two people and one of them has a gun and he pulls it and he pulls the trigger, but it's empty, so it's click, click, click?
Yep.
What's the very next thing he does?
Throws it.
Throws the gun at the other guy, all right? Now, that happens in James Bond, right? In Casino Royale, that cool, cool parkour scene at the beginning, right? Those two crackers end up... One's a cracker. And they end up on top of this gantry or crane, which is like a mile high in the sky.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, the dude who was being chased by James Bond somehow gets hold of a gun or pulls a gun and points it at him and it's click, 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 right? So it's empty. So, of course, he throws it at James Bond.
Who catches it?
He catches it and throws it right back, hits the guy in the head. The guy falls off the fucking gantry. Fantastic. So the lesson is, if you're James Bond, doesn't matter if someone's whipping something at your head, you can catch it, throw it back. And it's the same move. He doesn't catch it and then wind up and throw it back. It's like, boom. It's fucking wicked.
That's your number one.
You know what? A gun has got fucking corners on it. If someone threw a ball at you that quickly, good luck catching it and throwing it back. But a gun, not because you're James Bond, bitch. That's how it is.
I'm James Bond, bitch.
By the way, that's so cool when it happens. I'm like, ooh, yeah, you're so good, cool, good bitch. Moment, why, you're so cool.
All right, well, my number one is, again, it's very encapsulating so many action films. And just probably, if you wanted to put all my nine into one, here it is. Yep. That's why it's my number one.
I see.
As a good guy, and I've, again, framed it from the first-person point of view.
Sure.
I can expect to have plot armor encase me almost all the time. Bullets will scythe past me. Powerful blows will barely clip me. And I will handspring back to my feet after being kicked in or around the torso in a manner hard enough to knock me off balance. This is unquestionable, and I am now aching for a fright right this second to prove this clear, unassailable, universal truth.
Every action film?
Yes.
Every action film. So you're saying that
there is no bigger rule than this. If you are the hero,
yep,
you are virtually Elliot Ness.
We're talking about the Untouchables.
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, funny thing. You're right. That's a good one. I mean, is there a... No, there isn't really this like convention with someone where the hero gets shot once or something like that. It's just a flesh wound, you know?
I do remember like
even so,
Rambo in First Blood Pass 2 having to take a red hot poker and stick it in a bullet wound.
Oh, yes, yes. That's right.
That could have been somewhere on my list, to be honest. Here's my honorable mention.
Yeah, but the thing that happens to you is never the thing that incapacitates you later. You know in Batman, at the beginning, sorry, the last Batman, the Nolan one, right? The Nolan
Dark Knight Rises.
Yep. At the beginning, it's well established that Bruce Wayne cannot walk properly because he has no cartilage left in his knees, right? Mm-hmm. So he builds an exoskeleton and becomes Batman again, and now it's all good because the exoskeleton doesn't fuck with his knees. Later on, he's in that fucking prison in the fucking ground, and they just never mention it. All of a sudden, his knees healed. Just shit like that. Yeah. Always shit like that.
Yeah, that's right. Amazing regenerative powers.
Right. Weird little side note. Wyatt Earp, the real Wyatt Earp, never grazed by a bullet.
Wow.
Uh-huh. Bet he's the man, though. So what's up?
That's who Gun Carter is based on.
God, it is, brother. Man, why didn't I put a Gun Carter one in here?
We could have easily. There we are. That's Ellis. We hope you had a good time. Very weird.
Not sure how that went, everyone, but... Yeah.
Let us know.
Please.
Let's just do the feedback bit now. Let us know. Is this the kind of episode you'd like
sucked,
to hear?
If it just hit us up.
Or let us know if it would suck balls and you never want to hear this one again. Just go back to the normal shit, you dumb pricks.
Yeah.
Like, I changed my mind at last second. How do you do that? You do that via...
Googling The Countdown Podcast, and you will find it everywhere. Or you can send us an email at thecountdownpodcast@gmail.com.
On Twitter at TheCountdownPC, on Podbean where we host the show, you can make comments and like and follow the show there, or via our Facebook listening community. Link is in the show notes. Finally, ccradio.com.au, where we are with a bunch of other great Australian podcasts. All right, Wayne, that's that part. Len, let's get into what the listeners had to say, because there's been some really great responses,
yeah.
As you can imagine, in a segment that we call the Pop 10.
Talk about
Pop 10.
Talk about
Pop 10.
Kicking off this week's Pop 10 with Gerald from 2Ps on a Podcast, good friend to the show. He had a gif of Steve Carell from Anchorman 2. Having a trident definitely helps.
I forgot about that one. Nice.
I like that one. It's very good. Another good mate, Judy from Shaken Not Nerd Podcast. Snatch. Never underestimate someone's size.
Oh, yeah. Brad Pitt busting a cap and a cracker.
Phrasing.
Yeah,
that's right. Batman Begins. Mind your surroundings. And fuck it, Dragon Ball Z. Z. Training and pushing yourself pays off. Watch the damn movie / show. Sure. Okay.
Dragon Ball Z, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even I'm not that Asian.
The Cinema Guys, Brad from that show said, I learned all you need to do is a few household chores and you too can become a karate master.
Are we talking about Daniel-san?
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely spot on. Then Dan is Not the Problem had this really cute little gif of this Wolfman type thing. And he's got, Wolfman's got nards from Monster Squad.
Monster Squad.
I thought it was a great answer. John from the Pilot Comics Podcast, another patron to the show. All punches connect with the sound of a small explosion. There we are.
Yes.
So I've channeled that one. As has Julio. He said exactly the same thing there from the Contrarians Podcast. Sam from the Movie Reviews and 20 Cues Podcast. Number three, you can make a man's heart explode after take 5 steps if you hit them in the right 5 pressure
Kill
points.
Bill.
Number two, it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you get hit and keep moving forward.
The Sly Stallone speech.
That is it.
Fantastic.
And number one, when fighting aliens, he had the same thing. If it bleeds, we can get it.
Nice.
From Stephen from the Super Retro Throwback Podcast, wrestler versus actor. And we're talking here about They Live. Wrestler always wins.
Did Roddy Piper win that one?
Yep.
Okay.
Put on the glasses.
Yeah, I remember that now.
How dare you? Still any good? Sir on Twitter said, if you could do that crick crack thing with your neck, you're good at fighting.
Danny Glover owned that thing.
He did? Oh, yeah. Mm. Oh, yeah. Diplomatic immunity. All right. Chris Sutherland over in the Facebook listener community said, Fight Club, anyone can destroy something beautiful. From Winter Soldier, elevators were meant for awesome fight scenes.
Oh, man. That was the shit.
And from Dark Knight Rises, sometimes you just need only the noise of fist on torso.
Okay.
Nicole Presley said, putting up your hair mid-fight is sexy as hell.
That it is.
Number two, punching someone is not that hard or painful. Number three, getting hit in the face isn't that big a deal, which is kind of what we have alluded to there.
Very big.
Ray Dent said, I only learned one thing, sweep a leg. I like that one very much as well. From Adam Allure, another high-level patron to the show, top-level patron to the show, if you kill someone with a pencil, everyone will be terrified of you. That's a great one.
Dark Knight?
John Wick.
Oh, really?
If you kill... How do you... With a pencil!
Oh, that's right, that's right. Yes.
Jeez,
good call, good call, good call.
Always take the high ground from Adam, and the crane kick will fuck you up.
Uh-huh.
Kristen Acaro said, always begin with insult, like declaring, get away from her, you bitch.
Very nice.
Nothing cuts like Hattori Hanzo steel.
Yes.
And make sure to capture your flying high kick with a 180-degree camera panning freeze frame.
Except those shitty ones I was talking about.
Antoine said the elderly Japanese man is always a more competent fighter than you.
Ah, Miyagi, of course.
Mm-hmm. Again. And Blake Jarvis also referencing once again Karate Kid. The crane kick is all you need, at least until Karate Kid 2 ruined that shit.
Mm-hmm.
Nicole Davis said always take that extra stab to make sure they're really dead. And Christiani replied with basic instinct much.
Yeah.
And then Mina Harker said, it's like I always say, the first three stabs are for the murder. The next 27 are to plead insanity. Some great stuff there. Philip Wilson said, you've got 5 sets and you're dead again from Kill Bill.
Mm-hmm.
You should be punching someone if it makes the noise of a semi-truck hitting someone. And anything and everything is a weapon, i.e. all Jackie Chan or James Bourne movies.
Oh, yeah. That's the best thing.
Last couple then to wrap it up. Ashley Gorski also referenced John Wick and saying, don't fuck with someone's dog.
That's the biggest one of all.
Yeah. That comes from the Rabbit Ears podcast, which is returned. If you haven't checked out Rabbit Ears,
kapow.
Go and do that shit. And lastly, Stephen Godfrey said, first rule of Fight Club is you don't talk about Fight Club.
Nice.
Which, of course, means you're fucked up there, Stephen.
See, that's the thing. When you drop little ones about this, it's all fine, right? Try making a show out of it.
Thank you to everyone who got back to us. It was a weird one. We didn't get as much feedback as we normally do, but we really appreciate people who took the time to try and come up with something clever.
God knows we thought it was hard.
Well, we did. Absolutely. It was definitely one of the more difficult topics on the show. All right, that's it for this week, episode 254. We hope you've enjoyed this little venture into the weirdness that is movie fight scenes.
And us.
We're returning to a bit more of a traditional one next week. Wayne, what are we doing for episode 255?
Don't know, cunt. Next week, we are going to be discussing the top 10 battle scenes in films.
Oh, yeah.
This big-ass battle, hairy-ass battles.
For years been on the list. We've got finally time to do this one. So we're not talking fight scenes, we're talking big battle scenes. So
this is
going to be at least what?
Two clashing sides, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So
in film.
Yeah. And how big does that crowd have to be?
It can be as big as you want.
And as small as?
This title of your sex tape.
Everyone, last night Paul and I went out for drinks, okay? And then he tells me that he's been watching a bit of Brooklyn Nine-Nine, right? Where there is a standing joke where anything a character says, people come back with, title of your sex tape.
Oh, just
so you say something remotely, yeah. You say something remotely sexual or nothing, and he'll say, title of your sex tape. So if that keeps coming up in the show,
I won't.
And you hate it, you tell him.
Or if you think I'm nailing it, and you think that should continue,
no.
If also tell
then
me.
Then maybe you don't, have ears. So...
Anyway, yes, so I would just say, can't be two small groups. That's not a battle, right? Like the Anchorman 2.
That's fight. A battle.
Is that a battle?
Are we sure carrying is, on? Man.
So anything bigger than how many people?
All right, I would say a battle needs, if it's 2-on-2, that's probably not a battle. Not a that's battle. More like a back-to-back
that's a
fight. So
3-on-3 is also not a battle.
I don't know, man. You're getting there.
Nah.
All right, what, 5? Five
say,
a side?
I would say at least 10.
10 each side.
Otherwise, it's a brawl.
All right. All right, fine. So like a bar fight, at least 20 combatants.
20 combatants.
All right.
Approximately 10 each side.
All right.
All right, that's the rules. There
20,
we are.
20, there. All right,
You've heard it here. So get it. Let us know your choices for next week, and we should have a lot of fun with that. I'm sure Saving Private Ryan will not rank any higher. Number 7 on Wayne's list.
Who says it's going to turn up at all?
Oh!
Oh, shit! All right.
You can't handle the truth.
That's it then. All right. Thank you so much for joining us again today for this episode. It's been a hell of a lot of fun, if weird as fuck.
Yes, that's big time.
My name is Paul.
My name is Wayne.
And of course, you listeners are.
Fine, we're talking about fine.
And that's been the Downboard. Catch you next week.
Later.